Let's start our session on classes, object-oriented programming. Okay, so last week we looked at file I/O and we saw how to create a file, how to read and write from, to read from or write to a file. And once we are done, it's a good practice to close a file. We also looked at exceptions. So exceptions help us write clean code which also takes care of error conditions. Okay, and we also saw how to take preventive actions in case something untoward happened. Okay, so we looked at try, then except, else, finally, all these keywords and how to use them. So, in certain sense, most of the programming aspect of Python are already covered, but now we are going to look at how to create good programs, how to create programs that are easy to read, easy to understand, and easy to maintain. Okay, so classes allow us to create large programs which are modularized so that different people can concentrate on different development of different parts. At the same time, users can get better documentation in some sense, better understanding of the program. Okay, so before classes, I think last time we could not cover a module, so let me just cover it very quickly. So in tutorial you have already seen modules. So modules are also a way provided by Python to organize programs for easier understanding and easier maintenance. So you can reuse same functions across programs without copying its definition into each program. So earlier we suggested that if you have a prime function which you want to use in three different assignments, you should copy it in these assignments and then run it. But modules give you a way of reusing the function in different files. Okay, and you must be doing it already in your matrix plus salary assignment. Okay, so Python allows putting such definitions in a file, and then you can use this file in a script or in interactive instance of the interpreter. So such a file is called module, and the process of using definitions from a module is called importing. Okay, so definitions from a module can be imported into other modules or into the main module. So it's not that you just import module in your final program, but other modules can also use definitions from some different module. Okay, so that's very convenient. Okay, so a module is a file containing Python definition and statements. So if you look at it cursorily, it will look very similar to any other script that you have written. Okay, so file name has to be associated with the .py suffix. This is how Python finds it when you ask for import. And an important property of module is that within a module, the module's name itself is available in the global variable underscore underscore name underscore underscore. So we will see very soon that these double underscore variables play some special role in modules as well as classes. Okay, so here is an example. So I am writing a module fib.cy, fib.py. Okay, and it's in some directory, we don't really care about it much, but so the idle shell or spider shell will tell you where this file lies. Okay, and within this module you can see that I'm just writing certain definitions, so it's no different from any other Python program that we have written. Okay, so any questions up to this point? So only special thing that happens when you write a module and when you run it is that you get the name of the module, for example fib fib in this case, in a variable underscore underscore name underscore underscore. Okay, so I will see some example. So let's suppose the code on the left hand side is what I wrote in the fib module. Okay, so all these definitions are part of fib module. And now I want to use these definitions somewhere. So I can say import fib. What this command does in Python is it will read all the contents of the file named fib.py. and then you can access the functions inside this file as if they are written in the current shell or current script. Okay, only difference being that the function name will be qualified with the module name. So if I want to use function fib up to, I can use it as fib dot fib up to by passing appropriate parameters. Okay, so any questions? Yeah. So it is as if I have written a function fib dot fib up to in my current shell or current script. Okay, I can call other functions and I can also look for the variable fib dot underscore underscore name underscore underscore. Okay, so I may not be pronouncing underscore every time because it becomes slightly cumbersome. So the thing to note is you don't have to override this variable. It is automatically set by the Python interpreter. Okay, so it automatically gets it from the import command in a certain sense. Okay, so within a module, the module's name is available as a global variable. So this is also important. This name is kind of global. It can be accessed from anywhere. Okay, so the problem with this model is, suppose I have certain functions which I don't want to show to others. So in this case, all three functions were supposed to be useful for other users. But in certain cases, I might be doing some intermediate computation which I don't want users to see. Okay, so Aniruddha has a question. If the fib is in a different directory, do we have to use absolute path? You either have to use path, or there is a way of telling Python to look for modules, so something very similar to class path. Okay, so it is possible to keep all your modules in a different directory as well. But for simplicity, in this currently I am going to use examples where module files are all in the same directory. Okay, so right. So in some cases I and that's okay. So Dhananjay has some comment. Let me just see that. So Dhananjay is asking, I tried to import OS module and define CWD and that seems to show that day. So Dhananjay, I will unmute you. I am not very clear about the question that you are asking. So let me just unmute you. Yes, please go ahead.
No, what I was trying to say is that you could see the current working directory by importing the OS module, I think. That's what I was looking at today. So I was just trying to respond to Aniruddha's question. So you can do get current working directory, I think. And then you can also change the path of locating your various files.
Right. So in fact, if you see when you run a spider program, so let me just run it, don't look at what this code is. So first thing it does is it will do a run dir command, run file command, in which it also sets working directory. Okay, so in this way you can also change. So this is nothing but a Python command which is changing working directory as well. Okay, so there are different ways of setting current working directory and similarly getting it. So unfortunately, this course is way too short to cover specific aspects of different modules and different functionality given by Python. So you will have to rely a lot on Python documentation as well as websites like Stack Overflow, and there are other Python learning websites like Go Dive into Python and so on. Okay, but thanks Dhananjay for bringing this up.
No problem.
Okay, so yeah. Okay, so Tejas has another question. Let me just. So Tejas is asking, Ame, how about nested import? For if, example, if fib.py in this example had imported some other module, can we still access it? Okay, we still have to import the module. I will try this and give you a complete answer sometime later, or we can start this as a discussion on Talent LMS website. Okay, so unfortunately we did not use all the features of Talent LMS but towards the end I want to use them. So Prasanna, can you post this question on Talent LMS discussion forum so that we can start a discussion? Okay. So I suppose if you import, let's say, math library in fib.py, then you cannot directly access maths function in your main module. You will have to explicitly import it. Okay, but I have not tried it. I will check it and get back to you. Okay, so let's come back to our discussion on importing. So in many cases you do not import all the functions, okay, in which case you Python allows you to import specific functions from a module, and it also gives us three different functions. But suppose I am only interested in fib up to some number, so I can use this syntax which says from a module import a specific function. Okay, so this is the syntax, and once I do this I get fib up to as if I have defined it in the current file itself. Okay, so I can give more names as comma separated values. So in this case I don't have to qualify it with fib dot. So this is the difference between using simple import and using from module import function. Okay, in certain cases you okay, so if I import just fib up to, I will not get definition of other fib functions, so I will get that this particular name is not defined, so there is an exception. So this is a very convenient way of importing only things that you want, and the second advantage is that you don't have to write long names like fib dot fib up to. But on the other hand, this can be confusing if you have large project where it might happen that multiple modules provide same function. Okay, so yeah, so in this case we bring only imported functions in the current script or current symbol table. So symbol table is again a technical term for things that compiler knows are within scope, and in this case there is no name of qualifying the function name with the module name. Okay, so it is also possible to import all functions in a way we don't have to put qualifying module name. So you can just say from fib import star. In this case it's as if all the contents of fib were written in the current file. Okay, only difference being that there are some special names which are not brought into current scope. For example, so special names are all beginning with an underscore. Okay, so if you want to put certain functions private to a module and some other functions public, then using import star will bring only non underscore names in the current symbol table. Okay, so Anirudh has a comment that using import specific functions, using from import syntax brings into account some efficiency. Okay, and it's obvious. So if you have very large library, for example math library has many functions. Okay, so if you bring all of them into current symbol table, then you are making compiler inefficient because you are consuming more memory. And if you have a really huge program which imports many libraries, this can be a cause of slowdown. Okay, however if you import a specific function, so then you are only bringing into memory things which are really required, so it can give you certain efficiency in terms of runtime. So Anirudh, thanks for bringing this out. Okay, so again the idea will be when you are not sure about a module, when you are developing things, you can use import to bring in lot of function, but slowly as you are clear about your end goal, you know which exactly which functions you are going to use, you can bring in specific functions in the current script. Okay. So there are certain special symbols which are defined by Python. So one we already saw, underscore underscore name, double underscore name, double underscore. So the convention is double underscore names are typically provided by Python compiler or Python interpreter itself. Okay. Single underscore names are considered to be private names which are kept within certain scope, which are not exported beyond that scope, and normal names are public, anyone can use them. Okay, so it's a very good idea to follow all these conventions, because unlike Java or C++, Python is not very strict in these rules. Okay, so Python does not give you a way to specify private things versus public things, so everything depends on the conventions. Okay, so when you have your module in a script, some .py, for example fib.py, so you can either import it, or it is also possible to run it on command line using Python interpreter command, so python fib.py, or in certain cases you can directly run fib.py if you have your paths set properly and if you add certain commands at the top. Okay, so I'm not going to go into the details of how to run fib.py directly, but suppose you are running it on command line, then what can happen is, in this case, the code in the module is behaves as if it was imported, but underscore underscore name in this case is set to a different value. It is no longer set to name of the module fib, but it is set to the string underscore underscore main underscore underscore. Okay, so why this is so? So this is a very convenient way of using a module as a script as well as a library. Okay, so if you want to import a module as a library, you do it, but you can also run it on command line by putting certain code at the end, and the code has this format. So you test whether the name variable is set to string main. Whatever code is under this block, it will run only when you run this module on command line. Okay, so when fib.py is imported as a module, name will be set to fib, and therefore this if test will fail. As a result, this particular code here will not run. But if you run this file on command line as python fib.py, in that case this name will be set to main and the code inside will run. Okay, there is a way to handle command line arguments as well, and I will explain it with an example. So when you pass command line arguments to a script, Python uses this sys module, and within sys a variable called sys.argv to hold all the arguments passed onto the command line. Okay, so if I have this particular code, if name equal to main, import module sys, and then run fib.iter on first argument that was passed. So sys.argv1 will be the first argument that is passed, sys.argv0 will be the name of file itself, so fib.py. So what happens in this case? This code will take first argument, convert it to an integer, and pass this integer to the function fibiter that was defined in the file. Okay, so if I run this code like this, python fib.py followed by 10, then I am calling iterative Fibonacci number with argument 10, and I get a result 55. Okay, so this is a nice way to run a command from command line, parse the argument and pass it to appropriate functions. Okay, on the other hand, if this module is imported by some other script, then code inside the if block will not run, and therefore nothing will be printed. Okay, so any questions here? So please raise your hand, because I think I have muted you all. I can unmute or send a request on chat. Okay, so if there are no questions, we'll move forward. And moving forward, we have quiz number 36 on Talent LMS website. Okay, so let's come to quiz 36. So there's just one simple question here. Okay, so choose the best option among the ones which are given. So hopefully everyone must have done it by now. So let's look at the answer. So in this case, I have a module mod which defines two functions, print high and underscore underscore print. Okay, now within my current script, I am using specific import of a specific function. In this case, even though I am trying to import all function, import star will import only those functions which do not start with underscore symbol. Okay, and therefore the first option is definitely wrong. Print can means it's not even a keyword. We had this very early in our discussion. And then underscore underscore print, it is a valid function name. Python allows you to name use underscore in names. That import star imports only the first function from a module. Again, this is a deliberate incorrect statement. Import star imports all functions barring those which where the name starts with underscore. Okay, so the fourth answer should be correct here. Okay, so this way import, I wanted to cover this few features which were not covered in details in the lecture. Okay, so any questions or comments, please send on chat window. Okay, so let me just open the other slides. Okay, so this is now where I think most of you are interested, because in the original survey many of you wanted to understand classes and object oriented programming. And even though I don't want to disappoint you, once you have learned programming, classes and object oriented programming will be an additional concept which is not very difficult. Okay, so it should be easy to understand. So why do we need classes? So remember, up till now we have been using data types like integers, floating points, strings, lists, dictionary, etc. Okay, but we had no way of creating our own data type. So we could use dictionaries, or we could use dictionary of list, or we could use floating point or a list of floating point and so on. We could mix and match them, but there was no way I could say that, oh, I am in a world, I want to use a complex number. Okay, even though Python provides it, but complex number is a good example. Okay, so using these data types, we cannot create our own data type. So Python does provide us some way of doing that. Okay, so here is another motivating example. Suppose I want to develop a geometry package in which the basic type I want is a point, okay, and assuming rectangular geometry, every point is identified using two numbers, an x coordinate and a y coordinate, okay. So what I can do is, in my program, I can use two floating point numbers, point x and point y, okay. So, and everywhere I want to use a point, I will use these two variables, okay. So yes, I can write a program which will be correct, which might work as expected and so on, but there is a big issue here. And what is the big issue? It's not a good programming practice, because there is no way I can decipher from this information that point x and point y correspond to the same data or same object, okay. They correspond to the same point object in my program, okay. I can do it again using disciplined use of variable names. So anytime I want to discuss point 1, I will say point x1 and point y1. Anytime I have to use some other point, I will use point x2 and point y2. However, once you are in a big group where there are some few tens or few hundreds of programmers, maintaining this discipline becomes harder, okay. And even a small mistake, instead of point 100, you by mistake say point y101, okay, it will make all your program incorrect and difficult to debug, okay. So in certain sense, we are missing a glue that should combine these two variables, point x and point y. So what is the better way? And let's look at another practical example, and this should relate with most of you, this should relate to most of you. Suppose you are asked to write a program to manage customer account for a large bank. So in a rare case, maybe you can do with point x and point y, point x1, point y1. Now in this case, for every customer you have several different features. So there is an account number feature, which is possibly an integer. There is an account type feature, again it could be an integer or some kind of a set of strings, okay. You have customer name, which will be a string, customer address, another string, and finally maybe you are storing signature to verify it later, okay. So this signature could be an image which can be stored as a list of two dimensional matrix of bits, okay. So all this information you have to manage, all this information belong to every customer, and suddenly when you are dealing with thousands of customers, you are really dealing with 5,000 different variables, and maintaining discipline is going to be really, really difficult, okay. So that's why we cannot depend on programmer discipline, we have to introduce discipline within the language itself. So managing related variables is cumbersome and error prone, and we would like to have a way which enforces the gluing together of these variables, okay. And along with these variables, there are operations which are specific to this particular object or variables when it is part of a particular object, okay. So there might be an operation like get next account number, which may look like it works on any integer, but which is really specific to the account number of a customer, okay. So we want to have some way of adding operations and gluing them together with these variables, okay. So what we really want is a new type, and remember, a type is nothing but a set of values along with the operations that are valid on those values, okay. So we really need to create a new type or our own type. So Python supports the concept of abstract data type, okay. So what is an abstract data type? So you define a set of objects and you define what are the operations on those objects, okay, and you glue these things together. What gluing means is, whenever I want to pass one element, okay, in general I will be able to pass the whole object, which includes every variable or every element in that object along with all the operations that are defined on these objects, okay. So from one part, I can pass a customer object to another part, and along with this object, everything about the customer will be carried. So the name of the customer, the address of the customer, signature and everything. Okay. So what I mean by carrying together means the other part will be able to access it as if it was passed to it separately. Okay. So typically abstract data types are defined using interfaces. So interfaces define specifications of the operations. So these are conceptual things. They are something you will not program, but you have to be clear before you start designing your own types. Okay. So an interface is the specification. So this tells you what all operations you need on the object. Okay. At this step, you don't really tell how to do it. So if I want to create a new customer, I would like to know what will be the next customer ID. I don't really care whether the customer ID is a string or an integer or in some case maybe a floating point number. Okay. So I define that I need a customer ID and I should have a way of getting next customer ID, but I don't define how to obtain this. So the important point about these abstractions is, and this is all part of object-oriented programming. So what we are defining is a barrier. So there are certain consumers who are going to use these types, who will depend on what is defined in the types. Okay. And then there will be another set of people who are the programmers who will develop the data type. They will manage the internals. Okay. They will tell how to exactly how to obtain next customer ID or exactly how to get all the accounts of a customer. Okay. The end user is isolated from how part. He is only interested in getting the list of all the accounts held by a particular customer. So having this kind of barrier allows us to manage complexity of the program. Okay. Because even if internals of a function change, the end user is not going to suffer as long as the interface remains the same. Okay. And classes are the way to implement abstraction. So last two slides was more about philosophy. The slides from now on are about implementing the philosophy. Okay. So given this nice concept about abstractions and barriers and information hiding, okay, how do we really implement it? So Python has the concept of class. A class in Python consists of two things. You have data and you have functions. Okay. So functions in a class typically operate on data available inside the class, and data defines attributes or properties of a particular object that you have in mind. So if it is a point object, it will determine the x attribute or x coordinate and y coordinate. If it is a customer object, it will data will be its name and address and so on. Okay. Functions, these are kind of actions which will manipulate attributes of the class. So any questions up to this point? Okay. So there's a lot of theory going on as of now, but object-oriented programming is nothing but theory. Okay, if you just want to read it, but when you come to implement it, you will see it's very similar to what all we have done, just that we have to create some kind of these barriers. So we have to explicitly put certain restrictions in the code. Okay. So let's look at class definition in Python. So Python, there is a keyword called class, and whenever you use keyword class, this itself defines an object, and the type of this object is also called type. So even if it is confusing, don't worry too much about it right now. Okay. So the main thing in Python is that everything is object and everything has type. So even when you define a class, that itself is an object and it also has a type. The name happens to be type, which in my view is not a very good choice. But in certain sense, it tells that, okay, you are really in an abstract world right now. Okay. So when you define a class and when you run it, okay, so you can use this definition to create an object. So you really have to explicitly create objects. Just by putting the definition, you cannot get an object. What you get is an object of name class, which itself has type type. To get an object of the created type, you have to instantiate the class. All class methods also have a type called method descriptor in Python 3. But once again, it is more for a knowledge purpose rather than, it's not very useful unless you are going into internals of Python. Okay. So what are the operations that we can do on class? We can instantiate a class. So this is the way you can create an object of the new type that you have developed. Okay. So suppose we have a class named complex num, then we can create a complex number variable Z by assigning it to this particular syntax. So we have the name of the class followed by and use it as a function name. So I followed by open parenthesis, close parenthesis, and in some cases you can also have parameters here, okay, as part of this. So it looks like using class name as a function. Okay, so this will create an instance of object of type complex number and hold its reference in a variable named Z. So from now onwards, unless I change Z, until I change Z, Z will contain an object of type complex number. Okay. What do I do with this thing? So I can access the attributes or the functions inside complex number, defined inside complex number, using dot notation. So for a complex number, we all know that there is an operation called conjugate. So supposing I have defined this operation, I can call conjugate operation on the complex number. Okay. So at this point, let's look at complex number class that I have defined. Okay. And we'll just spend some time over different statements. So there's some issue. Okay, so on the left hand side in my spider window, you can see a class complex number. So since I am using certain mathematical math function here, I am importing math library. Okay, so let me start from the start. So I have a file named something, in this case 12complexnum.py. Okay, hope everyone can read it. And in this name, I am defining my complex class. Okay, so the name of the file does not matter, unlike Java. So Java requires class name and file name to be same. In Python, you can have different name of file than the class name. So within this file, I can do whatever I want. So in particular, I am creating a class. The name of the class is complex num, and note this point, we'll discuss it. Okay, so I am passing object, which also happens to be an object of or the name of the class object to this class. Okay, so can everyone see the screen clearly? If not, please send a chat window, because this is important discussion. Okay, so this is the syntax. Whenever you are defining a class, you say keyword class followed by the name that you want, and within parentheses you pass name of parent class or the class whose functionality this class is going to be using, your class is going to be using. In this case, complex number will use certain functionality from object class provided by Python. Okay. After that, I have something similar to a document string, doc string. So this is also documentation for this class. Okay, so if I do help complex num, I will get this string on the command line. So let me also try show that. Okay, so I have already loaded this file. I can say help complex num. So I get this documentation string as part of help. Okay, so it tells me that this is a class to implement complex numbers, and not only that, it also tells me all about the functions that are defined inside this particular class, all the all the member variables and so on. Okay. And it also returns documentation string of individual functions. So help will give me complete help about the class that I have defined. After this, I have defined certain functions like init, str, getReal, which will return the real part of a complex number, getImagery, and so on. Okay. So as we saw, our complex class is a set of functions and certain data. Okay. So if you notice, I don't have any data defined anywhere. There is no x variable or y variable defined, or real variable or imaginary variable defined anywhere in this class. Something what we do in Java or C++, everything is a function definition. So then where is the data here? Okay. So we'll come back to this question in a moment. So if there are any other question, please go ahead. And please ask, because the way class is implemented is Python is sufficiently different from Java or C++. Okay. So it makes things easier for user to use classes, but at the same time it makes things confusing as well. Okay. So if you have any question, please raise your hand or send a chat window. Chat in the, yeah. Okay. So you can see lot of functions defined here. Okay, we are really not going into the body of this file. And okay, so all these files have been shared on ACADS website. So if you go to ACADS, and let me just go to learner mode. So you can download this. So if you have missed it earlier, so ignore this part. So let me begin. Okay, so you can see a file section at the top, and we are sharing many files here. So the files corresponding to today's lectures are in L10 files, lecture 10 files. Okay, so yeah, so let's come back to our class. So Saurabh has a question. What is the difference between a Java class and a Python class? So Saurabh, yeah, you joined a little late. So fortunately you have joined not that late, so we will be discussing the differences very soon. Okay, so I was just showing how to create a class in Python. The way you create classes using keyword class followed by the name of the class, and then you pass the name of some parent class that you want to get some attributes from. Okay, we'll talk about inheritance very soon with an example. But this is the syntax. So we have just discussed about syntax. We are still not we have still not discussed major differences. Okay. So let's start working on this. So once you have a class, you can instantiate it by using class name as a kind of function. Okay. And then after you have a reference to the class in a variable, you can use dot notation to access data and functions within the class. So in this case, z.conjugate will call conjugate function in the class complex number on object Z. Okay. So we just saw the class for complex number. The differences with respect to Java, so please listen to all these things attentively. So in case of Python, we have special methods which are treated differently from other methods. So the special methods are marked by their name, and name starts and ends with double underscore. So we saw that there is a method called double underscore init. This is a special method. Similarly, double underscore str underscore double underscore and so on. Okay. So all these methods are special. So what are these? So what do they do? So underscore init. So whenever you want to create a new object, this function is the one which gets called. Okay. So when I said z equal to complex number and parenthesis, init is the function that gets called. And in Java or C++ like language, we call this a constructor. Okay. So this constructs the object. Okay. Unlike other languages, only one constructor is allowed per class. So you cannot have multiple definitions for init with different arguments. In Java or C++ you can do it. So then how can I have a default constructor versus a non-default constructor? So example is, let's say I want to create by default a complex number 0 plus i0, but I should also want a way to create a complex number 2 plus i5. Okay. So in this case, we have to use default arguments. So you pass default arguments of 0, 0 to mimic multiple constructors. Okay, so let's look at our example once again. Okay, so yeah, so in this case I have an init function, okay, which takes three arguments. First argument is called self, second argument is r equal to 0, and third, so this is default argument having a value 0, and third argument also has a default value 0. Okay, so what I am going to do in init is, I am going to say self.real equal to r and self.image equal to i. Okay, so something very complicated is happening here, right? So before that, a quick question from Tejas. He is asking, how do we indicate end of class definition? He has asked to entire audience, so I will open this question to entire audience. So it's the same way we do find the end of everything else. Okay, so let me just go down. And so yeah, so this is where my class ends. And how do I know that? It is because the next statement starts at zero indentation with respect to class keyword. Okay, so yes, in Python, answer to anything or any scope related question is more often than not the indentation. So indentation tells you where class ends. Okay, so let's come back to our initial init constructor. So first thing you see is that we have a non-default argument self. Okay, but when I ran this program, when I run the program, in the program I do not have any arguments to complex number. Okay, so what is going on here? I don't have a default argument, and at the same time I'm not passing any argument to underscore init. Similarly, if I want to create a complex number 2 plus 3i, I am not passing any argument to init, okay, or any argument to, or any value to self. I'm just saying 2 and 3. And if I just run this program, so once again let me run it, and if I run this test driver, so I will not go into all the details now. So what I say is z2 is 2 plus i3, okay, which means number 2 is getting as real part of the complex number, number 3 is going as imaginary part of the complex number. But when I see the definition of init, real part is argument number 2, imaginary part is argument number 3. Okay, so the answer here is Python has this sort of weird syntax where first argument to any class method is derived from the object reference itself. Okay, so this is similar to the keyword this in Java. So if those who have programmed in Java or C++, they will know this keyword called this. Okay, so self here is equivalent of the this reference in Java. However, unlike Java, you have to pass it explicitly. Okay, you have to say first argument of class object is self. Other thing is, self is not a keyword. I can just call it anything else. I can call it dummy or whatever. Okay. So, yes, if I run this program, okay, so I will put a bad comment here. Okay, so the program will run without any issue. And I can even run it. So you can see that Z2 is still 2 plus I3, Z1 is still 0 plus I0 and so on. Okay, so the name really does not matter, but once again, Python convention is use the name self. And you can see even editor identifies this keyword. Okay. Secondly, we did not see any data points or data objects in Python. So whenever you use any variable using self dot notation in any of the method, the particular variable becomes a data object within the class object. Okay. So in this case, even though I do not create real and imaginary variables within the class, it is possible to create them whenever the object is instantiated. So in this case, real becomes real part of the complex number, image becomes imaginary part of the complex number for the object Z1 and similarly for the object Z2, and both of them have their own copy. Okay, so Z1 has real as 0, complex part as 0, and Z2 has real part as 2, complex part as 3. Okay, so are these points clear? So first thing, every function which wants to access methods of current, the data points of current object, they have to have this self argument. Okay, and the data gets created automatically whenever you assign it first time during the execution. Okay, as a matter of fact, I can create something out of create a new data object in some other function as well. Okay, this is also fine. However, I have to make sure that this function runs at least once before I can access the attribute. Otherwise, this attribute will not have a proper value. Okay, so this is something very different from any other language. So any questions? So other than that, things are pretty similar to Java or C++. So if I have Z3, I can call conjugate function. If I have a complex number Z2, I can call conjugate function. So if I look at conjugate, this thing is wrong. So conjugate returns the conjugate of self. Okay, so when I say z2.conjugate, what I really get here is the real part of z2 and the imaginary part of z2. So the complex number that I return will be 2 comma minus 3. Okay, so Anirudh has a nice question. He is asking, can I access the variables of complex numbers? So let me just show it to you. So I can do z1.real. Okay, so I did not actually, this is part of the test function, so I will have to create a new complex number on shell. And now I can say z2.real and z2.complex. Imaginary. Okay, so yes, it is possible to access data objects, and that is why it's a good practice to create all data components within init function itself. Okay, even though you can create it outside as well. So let me just do it here. Okay, so some problem with the keyboard. So I can do complex num 3 5, and then I can say z dot real Okay, but let me try to do z dot s, and I'm getting complex number has no attribute z, but let me just do something. So now you can see that z dot has an attribute str that I gave here. Okay, so what I did here, I will just cover in a moment. Okay, but somehow or the other, I called this function double underscore str on z. While running this function, I created the new attribute s, and once this attribute is created, I am able to access it. Okay, so once again, the caution is try to avoid creation of attributes outside init class, init function. Init is something which will be run the moment you create the object, and therefore all the required attribute will be created if they are part of init. Okay, only debugging attributes which you don't want others to see can be created inside other functions. Okay, so we saw this init function, and we also saw default argument to mimic multiple constructors. You can make them these constructors very complex. Okay, so let's look at the second important function, which is underscore str. Okay, so this function, if it is present in the class, it will be called whenever you call this function str. So from outside the class, if you call function str on the object, or whenever you call print on the object. So in this case, whenever I do print z, I am really calling this underscore underscore str function on the z object. Okay, and in this case it returns the representation as x plus iy. So if I say print z dot conjugate, so I am getting 3 minus i5, which is coming because an object complex number was created by conjugate call, and then the underscore str function was called on that. Okay, so underscore str is important whenever you want to have some kind of nice readable representation for the string, for the object. Okay, in this case the requirement is that return value must be a string, otherwise you will get an exception whenever you try to run this function. Okay, further, if you have objects which require comparison or equivalence checking, then you can define functions like underscore underscore lt underscore underscore le underscore gt and so on. Okay, so these are fixed names. So if you want to do less than on in some other script on the object, then you define underscore lt function. Similarly, for not equal to, you have to define underscore any. So if we look at our complex number class, we do have certain special function. For example, okay, so let me just cover one more slide. So similarly, arithmetic functions like plus minus, they also have equivalent underscore counterpart. So this is another difference from languages like Java or C++, where you have this kind of keyword like operator, or you can override the existing operator by putting the same name. In case of Python, you don't use operator themselves for overriding, you use these equivalent internal names like add, sub, mul, true div, float div and so on. Okay, so in this class we are just discussing few of them which are relevant to this particular example, but in the documentation you can see there are a large number of such functions. So I can add two complex number using underscore add function, subtract them, multiply, divide. Okay, so depending on whether you want to use single division, single slash or double slash, you use either true div or float div. Okay, and our test function does test all of these. So when I am computing z4, I am doing a multiplication of two complex numbers. Okay, so once again I can just run this program. So I created a test driver which does create z1, z2, z3, z4 and z5 and prints certain values on them. Okay, so you can see that because of the nice or at least nice according to me string function, I can see output in a readable format. So conjugate of 2 plus i3 is 2 minus i3, if I multiply two complex numbers, I am getting a some new complex number and so on. Okay, so there is a question by Tejas which will I will handle in a minute. Okay, I can do addition, subtraction, and I also wanted to show you use of exception handling here. So if you see, at some point I am using division by zero. So complex number z1 is 0 plus I0 due to default constructor, and I am printing z5 divided by z1. Okay, so if you remember complex numbers good well enough, you will know that division by complex number 0 is not defined, very similar to integer division. So here is my division routine, in which case I am trying to do certain division. Okay, however I am not explicitly handling doing some if then else to check whether other complex number is 0 or not. Okay, I just rely on the fact that complex number 0 will have its mod also as 0, and therefore there will be a division by 0 exception thrown by this complex number division. Okay, so can you see this? Okay, if I wanted to handle it myself, I would have written if absolute square is 0, then do something else, do something. That will add lot of code, okay, and it's not very readable. In this case I am saying, okay, just go ahead and try the division, if something bad happens, give the error message, okay, or raise an exception which the user or the consumer of this class should be able to handle. So this is the way you can raise exception in Python. You say the raise keyword followed by exception followed by a string giving you the some kind of error message. Okay, so here is the corresponding exception when I run the program. Okay, so while others are looking at the exception, I will just look at the question of what Tejas has raised. So Tejas is asking, slope class at minimum needs to have an init and str method, otherwise it would be an invalid class. Not necessarily, Tejas. So if your class is not at all useful, you can just give it a pass method. Okay, so by default, if there is a default init method which does nothing, it does not create any of data members, or it does not do anything. Similarly, if you do not give any str method, okay, so it will inherit str from the parent, which happens to be object in this case. Okay, so very soon we will start inheritance. I'm not sure if I will do it today, okay, but the next class definitely we will look at inheritance, where you pass certain attributes and functions from one class to another related class. Okay, so init and str are nice to have, because that way debugging your code becomes easier, but it's not mandatory. Okay, there is a default init which will get called. Okay, so for example, having a class empty, and I can have this class. Okay, and there is a well-defined class empty in my repository or whatever my shell. Now the type of empty is type, but if I say e equal to empty, I will get an object of type empty. Okay, so in this case it's also qualifying it with the module name, but the main thing is the type is empty. Okay, if I look at help for empty, let me just check what happens. I did not give any init or any docker string, so still some minimal things have been added. So you have some kind of dictionary and some kind of weak ref, which are Python internal things, but in reality this class is more or less empty for any useful purpose. Okay, so that's about the minimal class. So minimal class is a pass class. What is a weak reference? Okay, so I really don't want to go into that. So weak reference comes in the context of garbage collection. So where you don't have any variable which points to certain object, however there are certain internal data structures which are pointing to an object. Okay, so but let's ignore it from for this class. Okay, so this is some kind of internal Python bookkeeping. It wants to keep this particular class in memory or the objects in memory. Okay, so we'll not discuss weak reference in this class. Okay, so here is our practical example revisited. So our earlier class complex number was still very easy. Okay, so let me see what is the time. So all right, so I will just discuss the skeleton of this class and we will start with the inheritance in the next lecture. So what I want to tell you about is, so suppose you are really doing a program for some bank client, your client is a bank, okay, and they want to create a database of persons which are involved in day-to-day operation. So in this case you have a nice case for object-oriented programming and something what is called inheritance. Okay, so what happens, any person who interacts with the bank can be captured by a class called person, and this will have attributes which are common to everyone. So for example, a name, every person will have a name, every person may have a will have a date of birth maybe, or maybe age, okay, or address and things like that, right? But bank, so this is a general class which can be used in many applications, but from bank's perspective they are interested in a subset of or a special type of people which really interact with bank. Okay, so a bank will require another class, bank person. However, you need not create all the attributes. You don't need to recreate name and address for a bank person if you already have names and address for a person. So this is where inheritance comes into picture. You can derive bank person from person, in which case bank person will be able to reuse attributes like name and address. Okay, now even after bank person, a typical bank will want to distinguish between customers and employees. And since both customers and employees are related to bank person, okay, so we have another level of hierarchy. So every customer is a bank person, every employee is a bank person. Okay, so this is what inheritance can be talked in terms of simple English. Whenever you have this relation is a, okay, so then you can think about inheriting from the so if I say X is a Y, then X should inherit from Y. So in this case customer and employee both will inherit from Y. Oops, sorry. Customer and employee both will inherit from bank person. And let's say our bank also wants to distinguish between two types of customers, normal customers which have a low bank balance or they have very, they don't have any loans, and then premium customers which have certain minimum balance, or they may have go for some loan, or they have some special relationship with bank. Okay, so once again we can see that a normal customer is a customer, a premium customer is a customer. Okay, so this way we are getting this tree kind of diagram. In general you can also have something called multiple parents or multiple child and so on. Okay, so this diagram is very useful when we are talking about object oriented paradigm and inheritance. Okay, so in the next lecture we will see how we will derive Python program to model this simple bank person and different variation of this person. Okay, so in this case remember that even though normal customer is a customer, we can also say normal customer is a person. So any property of person will be inherited by bank person, which in turn will be inherited by customer, which in turn will be inherited by normal customer. So normal customer is also going to have a name. Okay, so yeah, so that's all for today's lecture. If there are any questions, please send by chat window or raise your hand. Okay, so yeah, so there were a lot of concepts, so we did not have many quizzes this week, but next week we'll be back with more quick quizzes. Okay, so if there are no questions, then we will break for today. And I will again suggest, please attend the tutorials and attempt all the assignments because things are becoming interesting, but on the other end, we can make them interesting up to a certain limit. Okay, only when we interact with you, when we see your solutions, we get new ideas about how to make next assignment or next tutorial more interesting, more interactive. Okay, so please make sure you submit your assignment, and even if you do not meet deadline, ask us for extension. As you can see, we are very liberal in that. Okay, we will also accept email submissions in case you are really late, but please try all the assignment problems. Okay, the more you program, the more you learn, and the more we learn from you. Okay, so that's all for today. Thank you.